Hey folks, welcome to Digimento Education. In this video lecture, I am going to discuss the solutions to the questions asked in the Electronic Science June 2014 paper 2. Okay, so the next Electronic Science exam is scheduled to be scheduled on 8th of July. So it's important for you to go through all the questions which were asked in the previous year papers. Okay, let's begin our discussion. For the circuit shown, let's have a look at the first question. For the circuit shown in the figure, the terminal voltage VAB is given by what? So you can see that since this is open circuited, no current will flow here. So let's say the current will be equal to zero. So current that will flow in this branch will be equal to 2 ampere. It's quite clear. Let's say the voltage, node voltage, the voltage at this node, let's say is VC. And this voltage that is appearing across 2 ampere current source is VAB. Okay, because VAB and 2 ampere are connected in parallel to each other. So if we apply the KVL in this loop in this fashion, you get minus VAB minus 3 VAB plus VC is equal to 0. So VC will be equal to 4 VAB. This is the first equation that we got. Now 2 ampere, if we apply KCL in this particular branch, we know that 4 VAB minus 4 volt divided by 10 is equal to 2. Is it clear? Okay, so 4 VAB minus 4 divided by 10 is equal to 2. 4 VAB minus 4 is 20. And if you solve, you get 24 is equal to 4 VAB, and VAB is equal to 6. So the answer to this question is 6 volt. So option B is the correct option. Let's have a look at the next question. Just make a small change here. The current should be 2 milliampere. Okay. The current should be 2 milliampere. If it is not in milliamperes, the voltage would, if the current was not in milliampere, the voltage would have been, the voltage would be in millivolt, which is not in the, which is not in this case. So this current should be 2 milliampere. So then only milli and kilo will cancel each other. Okay, then VAB will be equal to 6 volts. Let's have a look at the next question. The earth has a conductivity of 10 to the power minus 2 mho per meter. So we have the conductivity 10 to the power minus 2 mho per meter. Epsilon r is given to us as 10 and mu r is equal to 2, and frequency of operation is 10 gigahertz. We need to find out whether the earth is a good conductor, moderate conductor, good dielectric or bad dielectric. So we first of all find the loss tangent, which is basically a loss tangent. Okay, loss tangent. Sigma is known to us as 10 to the power minus 2 divided by omega is 2 pi f. F is 10 into 10 to the power 9 gigahertz into epsilon naught into epsilon r. Epsilon r is 10 into epsilon naught is 8.85 into 10 to the power minus 12. Farads per meter. Remember the units. If you solve for this, you get 1.79 into 10 to the power minus 3, which is less than 0.1. Okay, as sigma over omega epsilon is less than 0.1, earth is good dielectric. Okay, it's good dielectric. So just remember that is when sigma over omega epsilon is less than 0.1 and greater than 0, then the substance is said to be a good dielectric. Okay, good dielectric. Understood? The option C is the correct option. So C is the correct option. The velocity in a silicon pin photodiode with 25 micrometer depletion width, 25 micrometer depletion width, and the velocity of the charge carrier, which is 3 into 10 to the power 4 meters per second. The maximum response time of the pin diode is given by. Basically, this is a little bit ambiguous question. The response time, let me just as per my calculations, response time is equal to 13 WB squared by 1300 microsecond. Okay, if you plug the values in this, you get it as somewhat 4.8 nanosecond. Okay, so the option D is approximately the correct option, but I'm not so sure about the solution. Okay, let's have a look at the fourth question. For a JFET above the pinch off voltage, as the drain voltage increases above pinch off Of course, the saturation will occur. The drain current increases linearly, the drain current decreases, the drain current remains constant. So the option A is obviously correct. Okay, let's have a look at the next question. What bandwidth is needed for an FM signal that has a peak deviation of plus minus 3 kilohertz? So we have a peak deviation of plus minus 3 kilohertz. Okay, peak deviation of plus minus 3 kilohertz and handles audio signals from. So we are available with the message frequencies from 200 hertz to 5 kilohertz. Okay, they are basically the FM range. So we need to find out the bandwidth. Bandwidth is basically nothing but equal to 2 into delta F plus FM. Okay, 2 into delta F plus FM. So we know we need to find out that maximum bandwidth required. This will be equal to delta F, which is 3 kilohertz, plus FM is 5 kilohertz. A to the 16 kilohertz. So option B is the correct option. Okay. In which of the following base system 132 is not a valid number? In base 16, 132 is a valid number. Base 10 is also valid. Base 8 is also valid, but base 2 is an invalid number. So the option D is correct. We cannot write 132 to the base 2. We have to replace it with its corresponding boundary number, boundary representation in terms of 1010 and so on and so forth. So it's totally incorrect. So the option D is the correct option. Okay. What is the relation between K and T such that a unity feedback control system whose open loop transfer function is given to this is a stable system? Okay. In this case, it is said that the closed loop system is stable. So with the help of the open loop transfer function, we determine the condition for the stability of the closed loop system. So we know that the characteristic equation is nothing but 1 plus GHS, okay, is equal to 0. This is a characteristic equation. This comes out to be S into S plus 10 plus T plus K plus TS plus K is equal to 0. Okay, this so you get characteristic polynomial is nothing but S square into S plus 10 plus TS plus K is equal to 0. We get it as S cube plus 10S square plus TS plus K. Okay, this is your characteristic polynomial. Now, we perform the by using the RH criteria. RH criteria is used to determine the absolute stability of a particular system. S cube, S square, S to power 1, S to power 0. S cube coefficient is 1, and then T. Okay, we have then 10, and then we have K. So, this will be equal to this will be equal to 10t minus k divided by 10. This is 0, this is k. So for stability, k must be positive and 10t minus k must be positive. This implies that k should be less than 10t and should be greater than 0. So the option which satisfies our explanation is A. So the option A is correct. Okay. Now LSI, microprocessor development, had happened because of LSI. What is LSI? LSI is nothing but large scale integration. This is what is referred to in LSI. Okay, that gave rise to VLSI. VLSI is very large scale integration. Okay, stdio.h header file contains the functions related to prototypes of the standard input and standard output functions. No, it's wrong. Standard output functions. No, it's correctly is definitely wrong. Prototypes for the functions that perform input from files. No, it's totally wrong. Prototypes for the functions that perform input from strings in memory and output to strings in the memory is totally wrong. Option A is correct option. It's related to the prototypes of the standard input output library functions. Okay, so the option A is the correct option. 10th question. The threshold voltage of a MOSFET can be lowered by using a 300 gate oxide. Yes, totally correct. We know this thing that V threshold voltage is nothing but VT naught plus gamma square root of V. So substrate voltage VSB, substrate biasing voltage 2 phi FP, which is 2 phi FP is nothing but surface potential minus square root of 2 phi FP. Okay, this is your basically the dependency of VTH. Okay, where gamma is nothing but square root of 2 q epsilon si na upon COX. okay, and COx is nothing but square root of 2q epsilon si Na. I am writing it with respect to n-channel MOSFET, NMOS, okay, where the substrate is p-type. That's why I'm writing Na here. This is epsilon OX into TOX. So this is your gamma. Gamma is nothing but TOX into this thing. So if we decrease TOX, gamma decreases. If your gamma decreases, your VTH decreases. Hence, we can say that using a thinner gate oxide, your threshold voltage decreases. What else? Reducing the carrier concentration in the substrate? Yes, it is true. If you reduce the carrier concentration, your gamma decreases. If gamma decreases, your VTH decreases. So 2 is also correct. Increasing? No, this is totally wrong. So 1 and 2 statements are only correct. So the option B satisfies our explanation. An angular position to which a angular position to be measured with using a transducer. Which of the following types of transducers can be used for this purpose? Okay, so a circular potentiometer, yes it is true, we can use circular potentiometer for determining the angular position. Okay, LVDT cannot be used, e-pickoff no, synchro can be used. So the option D satisfies our explanation, so option D is the correct option. Okay, in a hybrid T, magic T, following parameters are given. Okay, so which of the following statements are correct? S11, S22, these are basically the S parameters or the transmission line parameters. They are usually used for two port networks. Okay, S11, S22, so they are basically used in antennas. These S parameters are used in antennas and so on and so forth, where S11 gives you the total reflected power and so on and so forth. Are non-zero? No, this is wrong. They are okay, this statement is correct. This statement is correct. They are all non-zero. All junctions are reciprocal. Yes, S parameter model jo bhi hoga, they are all reciprocal. So the option antenna is also reciprocal. We can say antenna is all reciprocal. An antenna is also reciprocal. Okay, so second statement is also correct. S11, S22, S33 and S44 are 0. S13 is equals to minus S23. S14 is equals to S24. So in my view, the option 1 and 2 are correct. And yes, they can also be 0. They can be 0. So option 3 is also correct. So 1, 2, 3 statement, D is, I think, the correct option. Okay. In optical fibers, following statements are given. 1550 nanometer is a 0 dispersion wavelength. Yes, it is true. It is absolutely true. 1330 nanometer is 0 dispersion wavelength. Yes, it is also true. Both the wavelengths are 0 dispersion wavelengths. In 1330 nanometer, attenuation is minimum. Yes, it is correct. So only 1, 2, 3 statements are correct. So option C seems to be correct. Okay, let me just go through this question. Wait. There is, I think, they are non-zero. No, it's not correct. Option D is not correct. Let me just say option 1 is the totally not correct. Option 2 and 3 can be correct, and option 4 is also, yeah, sorry, I didn't see. Option 4 is also correct. S13 is minus S23, S14 is S24, and S43 is 0, and S34 is 0. So the option C is the correct option. So make a change here. Option C is the correct option. Okay. Now, which of the following statements is a 0 dispersion wavelength? Attenuation is, this is also wrong. Only 2 and this third statement is also wrong. The second statement is correct. 13 nanometer is a 0 dispersion wavelength. So yes, it is true. At 150 nanometer, 1550 attenuation is minimum. Yes, it is also true. So only 2 and 4 statements. C is the correct option. Okay. Which of the following techniques are used to generate frequency modulated signal? So let's have a look at this question. Armstrong method, or yes, this is basically used to generate the frequency modulated signal. Yes, it is true. And Foster-Seeley discriminator, no, this is wrong. Balanced modulator is used for DSB signal. It's wrong. It's not used for this thing. Reactance modulator, yes, it is true. So option 1 and 4 are correct. So option D satisfies our explanation. Okay, let's have a look at this question. 15th. Which of the following statements are true regarding the operation of a JK flip-flop? When K input is low and J input is high, the Q open flip-flop is reset. No, it's wrong. It's false. It's false statement. It's 0. Okay. When K input is high and J input is low, the Q of the flip-flop is set. No, this is also wrong. This is also wrong. When both the inputs K and J are low, the output Q does not change. Yet, it's true. It is true. This is true. Okay. When both the K inputs RJ are high, if it is possible to set reset the flip-flop, that is the output toggle on the next positive catch. Yes, it is true. When both the inputs of JK flip-flop are 1, it is basically operating in the toggling mode. So option 3 and 4 are only correct. So option B satisfies our explanation. A linear two-terminal network can be replaced by an equivalent circuit consisting of a current source in parallel with a resistor Rn, where Rn is the ratio of closed circuit voltage to short circuit current at the terminal pair, no. Open circuit voltage, no. Open circuit current, no. Open circuit voltage to short circuit current, yes, it is true. Your R Thevenin is nothing but VOC upon ISC. Okay. So this is third statement is true. Fourth statement is also wrong. So only C option is the correct option. Okay. The following signals of microprocessor are interrupts. This is not intercept. This is interrupts. Okay. TRAP is an interrupt. INTA bar is not an interrupt. It's basically interrupt acknowledge. It's just to allow an interrupt to cause its action. Okay. IOM bar is input output. It's basically used for selecting the allowing the output or the output or the devices, external devices connected to the memory or the RAM of the microprocessor. So it's also not an but it is not an interrupt. Reset input bar, yes, it is an interrupt. So 1 and 4 B option is the correct option. Okay. C programming language can be considered as low-level programming, high-level programming, assembly-level programming, machine-level programming. Yes, 1 and 2 are correct. So the C option is the correct option. A linear two-terminal circuit can be replaced by an equivalent circuit consisting of voltage VT and a series resistor RT, where RT is the ratio of open circuit voltage to an open circuit current at the terminal pair. No, it's totally wrong. Open circuit voltage to short circuit current at the terminal pair, yes, it is absolutely true. Short circuit current to short circuit, no, this is wrong. The independent sources are turned off. Yes, it is also true. RT is found that way only. So 1 and 4 options are correct. So option A is the correct option. Semiconductors have the NTC of resistance. If we are talking about the intrinsic semiconductors, they definitely are and they definitely possess NTC of resistance. But we just talk about highly doped semiconductors, or you can say extrinsic semiconductors, after a certain temperature, that is 300 Kelvin, the NTC of resistance turns into or transforms into PTC of resistance. But in this case, we have to consider an intrinsic semiconductor in general. So we are going to mark the negative temperature coefficient of resistance. So option C is the correct option. Had it been specifically mentioned that we are talking about, had it been specifically mentioned extrinsic semiconductors, then the answer would have possibly been A. The answer would be A. Okay. Consider the following excimer lasers used for photolithography and surgery purposes. The correct sequence of the descending order of the wavelength of the operation is the first one would be XEF xenon fluoride excimer, which is laser, which is this first. And then we have xenon chloride excimer laser, second this. Arsenic fluoride, then we have third. And then AR2 excimer laser, which is the fourth option. So option D is the correct option. Arrange the following communication systems in the order of their available commercial bandwidth. So first is the minimum first So the true transmission line system has the minimum wavelength bandwidth available. So the fourth option will basically come first. So this is first, and then we have amplitude modulated system. This is second. This is third. And the fourth one is a satellite communication system. Satellite communication system has the highest bandwidth available. So satellite communication system basically use VHF ultra high frequency ranges. For example, ultra high frequency is basically from 300 megahertz to 3 gigahertz. Okay, bandwidth is quite large, as you can see. About 500 megahertz is the bandwidth, which is quite large, and very high frequency is about 300 hertz to 300 megahertz. So it's about that. Okay, so the fourth one is the option A is satisfies our explanations. Option A is the correct option. Okay, priority of the interrupts in the order of from the highest to the least priority. Of course, reset input bar has the highest priority, so this will come first. Okay, then we have RST 7.5, then we have RST 6.5, and then we have RST 5.5, which is this is the fourth option. So the option B satisfies our explanation. So option B is the correct option. Sequence of the operators according to the priority. So we have to arrange the sequence in the priority. First one is the asterisk. So first, second, and then we have plus, this is third, and this is fourth. So the option which satisfies the explanation is the D option. So D is the correct option. Okay. What is the correct sequence of the following steps in the fabrication of a monolithic bipolar junction transistor? First one is epitaxy layer formation, which is epi layer formation or the epitaxy layer formation. So fourth one will come first. Fourth one comes first. Then we have a buried layer formation, which is second. Then we have base diffusion, which is third. And then at the last, we have emitter diffusion. So this is the fourth. So option D satisfies our explanation. So option D is the correct. You should remember this is sequence, as you can see, as you basically analyze the previous papers, most of the questions are repeated. Okay. So you can expect this question to be repeated in the forthcoming examination. Okay. Okay. This question match the following. So del cross H, they are all the Maxwell's equations. So del cross H is basically matched to this, which is a third. So A is matched to 3. Del dot D is nothing but rho V, which is basically nothing but a Gauss law. Okay. So B is matched to 1. Del cross E again is matched to 2, which is C is matched to this. And del, so this is basically curl of gradient of f, of any vector f, is always equal to 0. This is solenoidal. And divergence of curl of any vector f is also equal to 0. This is irrotational. Okay, so you can see it's basically nothing but the divergence of the curl of f is always equal to 0. So option D is matched to this fourth. So the option B satisfies our explanation. So option B is the correct option. Okay, we have then multiplexer is basically select one of many inputs, single output. So A is matched to 1. Flip-flop is matched to memory. So B is matched to 3. Shift registers is basically a sequential logic. So C is matched to 4. And parallel is basically a combinational circuit. So D is matched to 2. So the option A satisfies our explanation. So option A is the correct option. Okay. Short noise occurs in the diode. Okay, it occurs in the diode. A is matched to 2. Johnson noise is basically matched to resistance. Okay, Johnson noise occurs in the resistance, which is B is matched to 1. Current noise occurs in the PN junction diode, or this is PN junction. So C is matched to 3. It occurs in the junction, and partition noise occurs in the triode. Okay, D is matched to 4. So the option D satisfies our explanation. So option D is the correct option. 1550 nanometer technology is basically matched to 4, which is 193 terahertz. Okay, which you just a conversion of the wavelength to frequency. So A is matched to 4. 0.8 nanometer is matched to 100 gigahertz. So B is matched to 1. Okay. 400 to 700 nanometer, the wavelength range is for visible light. So C is matched to 2. And 200 nanometer is basically for the ultraviolet light, which is D is matched to 3. So the option A satisfies our explanation. So option A is the correct option. N-channel JFET is better than P-channel JFET because you can see it's better frequency performance since mu n is greater than mu p. So A is matched to 4. And channel is wedge-shaped because of the reverse bias increases along the channel. So B is matched to 1. Channel is not completely closed at pinch off. So it is all because of the presence of the high electric field near the drain and directed towards the source. So C is matched to 2, and input impedance is high because low leakage current at the gate terminal or zero leakage current. So if you just consider the gate terminal, this is your gate, the current is almost taken as zero, or very current is very small. Okay, so D is matched to 3. So the option that satisfies explanation is A. A is the correct option. Now we have the flash converter, which is the fastest converter. So A is matched to 2. Successive approximation resistor type ADC is matched to 3. Okay, SAR type ADC is basically successive approximation resistor type ADC is matched to B, which is NN to TCLK, which is the conversion time of a SAR type ADC. Counter ramp uses a DAC in its feedback path. So C is basically matched to 4. Dual slope is basically integrated type. So D is matched to 1. So you can see that A is matched to 2, B is matched to 3, C is matched to 4, and D is matched to 1. So option A is the correct option. Okay. BJT, this is BJT, is used as high current gain. So A is basically matched to 2, so A is matched to 2. MOSFET has high input impedance, so B is matched to 4. Tunnel diode has voltage control negative resistance, C is matched to 1. And Zener diode is used for voltage regulator, as a voltage regulator, D is matched to 3. So the option A satisfies our explanation. Okay, we have the Gauss meter. Gauss meter is basically used for magnetic flux density, used for measuring the magnetic flux density. So A is matched to 4. Logic analyzer is basically matched to, is basically used for troubleshooting of digital electronic circuits. So B is used for 3. Okay. Pirani gauge is pressure management, measurement. So C is matched to 1. Rotameter is full of flow measurement. So D is matched to 2. So the option such as our explanation is D. So option D is the correct option. Okay, we have then the accumulator is basically your primary register to perform arithmetic and logical operations, which is absolutely correct. So A is matched to 4. Stack pointer contains the data from the stored data of the stored contains the data of the stored data from registers. So B is matched to 1. HL is basically a 16-bit register or 2-byte register, is basically used for storing address of the external memory. So C is basically matched to 2. And program counter contains the address of the instruction which has to be executed after completion of the execution of the present instruction. So D is matched to 3. So the option that satisfies explanation is C. So C option is the correct option. Okay. Superposition theorem is always applicable to the linear signals, linear systems. So A is matched to 2. You cannot apply a superposition theorem on non-linear systems. Okay. Thevenin's theorem is basically reduce some portion of the circuit to an equivalent source and a single element. Yes, B is for 4. Reciprocity theorem is ratio of the excitation to response is constant when the positions of the excitation response are interchanged. So C is matched to 1. And maximum power transfer theorem is only applicable to the Thevenin equivalent circuit. So D is matched to 3. So the option to satisfy explanation is B. So option B is the correct option. There's a paragraph type questions. A paragraph is given to you. Assertion or reason type questions. Okay, just have a look at these options and let's solve the questions. Okay. Brewster's angle is the angle of incidence at which there is no reflection, which is absolutely correct. Brewster angle, this is the basic definition of a Brewster's angle. It's only, basically there are two types of polarization. First one is basically the surface polarization. Surface polarization. In the surface polarization, the electric field wave is parallel to the surface. Remember, the polarization is always determined with respect to the electric field, okay, its magnitude and its direction. And the other type of this is parallel polarization. In this case, E field is perpendicular to the surface of the dielectric. Okay, now Brewster's angle only occurs, Brewster angles only occurs in parallel polarization. Okay, when gamma p is equal to 0, we can find out the Brewster's angle, but for surface polarization, Brewster's angle does not exist, because for that epsilon 1 will become equal to epsilon 2, which is not true, which is not at all true. If the wave is propagating from one medium to another medium, there should be a difference in their permittivities. And for the reflection to be actually equal to 0 in surface polarization, the permittivities of both the dielectrics must be equal, which is not true, okay, which cannot be the case. So only occurs in gamma p is equal to 0. And we know that gamma p is nothing but is eta 2 cos theta t minus eta 1 cos theta I divided by eta 2 cos theta t plus eta 1 cos theta I. Okay, understood? Let me just clean this thing up. I think you must have noted it. So I am removing this thing here. Okay, for further explanation, this is required. I don't have a space here. Okay, so if we just write, this is basically nothing but ER upon EI is gamma P. This is nothing but equal to epsilon 2 divided by epsilon 1 cos theta I minus square root of epsilon 2 divided by epsilon 1 minus sine square theta I divided by epsilon 2 divided by epsilon 1 cos theta I plus square root of epsilon 2 divided by epsilon 1 minus sine square theta I. Okay, this is your gamma p. This is basically calculated by replacing eta with mu naught upon epsilon, okay, r, because epsilon naught epsilon r, and using the Snell's law, we can find out the relationship between theta t and theta I. So replacing cos theta t term in terms of sine theta I or cos theta I, we get this expression. And if we make gamma p is equal to 0, let me remove this thing as well. So if we make gamma p is equal to 0, okay, now if we make gamma p is equal to 0, when gamma p is equal to 0, we get the Brewster's angle tan theta b, which is the incidence angle, theta I, this is basically your theta I, is equal to square root of epsilon 2 divided by epsilon 1 and sine theta b as square root of epsilon 2 divided by epsilon 1 plus epsilon 2. So you can see there are no epsilon 2 divided by epsilon 1 here. So the statement R is totally wrong. This is false, as you can compare from this expression. So only option A, assertion is correct. So the option C is the correct option. A is true, R is false. Okay. The EDFA is usually pumped at 980 nanometer wavelength, which means that erbium ions at ground level absorb energy, which is true. Okay. But this absorbed energy is transferred to the high frequency signals to boost up. No, this is false. So only option C is the correct option. D flip-flops are used as buffer registers. Yes, it is true. It is absolutely true. Okay. Flip-flops are free from race. No, this is false. All the flip-flops have race around conditions. That's why we go for master safe flip-flop to circumvent the race-around conditions. So option C is the correct option. Rao-Thurwitz criteria gives both absolute as well as relative stability using characteristic equation, which is absolutely wrong. This is only used for absolute, it is used for determining the absolute stability of a system. It is not used for the relative stability of the system, so this is totally false. Okay. For a system to be stable, all the roots of the characteristic equation must lie on the left half of the exponent, which is absolutely true. Okay, which is absolutely true. So option D is the correct option. A is false and R is true. For relative stability, we have polar plots and Nyquist plots. Okay, we have this. Polar plots and Nyquist, with the help of polar plots and Nyquist plots, you can easily determine the relative stability of the systems. Considering the two PNP and NPN transistors of identical construction as far as shape, size and doping are concerned, the NPN transistors have better frequency response. Yes, it is true. It is absolutely true because the electrons are the majority charge carriers and have the greater mobility. Electrons mobility is higher than that of the hole mobility. Yes, it is absolutely true. So option A is the correct option. Both the statements are true and R is the correct explanation of A. If a semiconductor is placed in a transverse magnetic field B and electric field E is applied across its two other faces, then it would produce an electric current I in the direction perpendicular to B and A. Yes, it is absolutely true. This is nothing but the basic definition of Hall experiment. Okay, basic definition of Hall experiment. Hall coefficient is proportional to the mobility of the charge carriers in the semiconductor. Yes, it is absolutely true. Okay. It is also true, but we cannot infer anything about the assertion from the reason. Okay. So the option B is correct. We know that sigma conductivity is nothing but mobility. Mu is equal to, we know the mobility is nothing but equal to sigma RH. Okay. From this relation, you can see that RH is proportional to mu. Option B is the correct option. 42. A monostable multivibrator can be used to alter the pulse width of a repetitive pulse train. Yes, it is absolutely true. Yes, we can say that. Monostable multivibrator has a single stable state. Yes, it is absolutely true. But R is not the correct explanation of A. So, option B is the correct option. In a two-port network with four terminals, four types of parameters like impedance, admittance, hybrid and transmission are considered and they are related to each other. Yes, it is absolutely true. The assumption made for the above statement is that there are no independent sources, yet it is true, non-zero initial conditions within the linear port network. Then only we can correlate all the parameters with each other. These conditions must be satisfied. There should not be independent source. There should not be non-zero initial conditions. Okay, zero initial conditions, it should not be zero initial conditions. So both the statements are true and R is the correct explanation to A. So the option A is the correct option. Move A08H. So it's basically referred to as an accumulator. We are putting a data which is addressed with 08H. Okay. So it means that the contents of the memory address 08H are moved to the contents of A. Yes, it is absolutely true. We can also write move AB. That's just referred to as the contents of B are put into A. Okay. MVI, this is nothing but this is basically MVI. Move immediate 8A to 82H. This statement MVI is basically immediate addressing mode. A82H. Basically means we are putting the data, which we are putting the 82H, an 8-bit number 82H directly into A. Okay, we are storing 82H directly into the accumulator. Okay, so it means that the contents of memory address 82H are moved to the contents of A immediately. So this statement is totally false. Had it been written that it means that the contents of memory, it means that 82H is moved to the contents of A immediately, then that would have been true. Okay. but this statement is false. So the option A is only, so the assertion is only correct. Option C is the correct option. To avoid repetition of code and bulky programs, functionally related statements are isolated into a function. Yet this is true. It is absolutely true. Function definition defines the body of the function. Yes, this is true. And R is the correct explanation of A. So option A is the correct option. So this is basically a paragraph type questions. So you just go through this paragraph, pause the video and just go through this particular paragraph. Okay. And then let's move on to the, questions. So, it is circularly polarized. Helical antenna is a circularly polarized antenna. Okay. This is a disc cone antenna. Disc cone antenna, I have written some points here about the disc cone antenna. So a disc cone antenna is a version of a biconical antenna in which one of the cones is replaced by a disc. It is usually mounted with the disc at the top and the cone beneath. Okay. So omnidirectional is basically an omnidirectional antenna, vertically polarized. Gain is similar to the dipole antenna. Okay. Radiation pattern in the horizontal plane is quite narrow, making its sensitivity highest. Okay. So it covers the frequencies of from 700 megahertz to 2 gigahertz. Very high supports very high frequency and ultra high frequencies. Ultra high frequencies are from 300 megahertz to 3 gigahertz, and very high frequencies are from 330 megahertz to 300 megahertz. Okay. So in one of the questions I discussed earlier, I wrote very high frequencies range from 300 hertz to 300 megahertz. Just make a correction there. It's basically 30 megahertz to 300 megahertz. Okay. Your biconical antenna, use another pen to make it more clear to you. A biconical antenna looks something like this. This is basically a biconical antenna. Okay. A feed is given here. This is your feed. Okay. And a conical disc cone antenna, there is a disc above and a cone beneath. This is a disc cone antenna. Okay. This is broad bandwidth antenna. This is broad bandwidth antenna. And this is wide bandwidth antenna. Wide band antenna. And you give the feed from here. You give the feed here. So option D is the correct option. Which of the following is antenna is best exerted from a waveguide? Yes. If we are discussing about the waveguide, is a horn antenna. Horn antenna is nothing but a waveguide. Okay. Which is a non-resonant antenna? A non-resonant antenna is basically a roaming antenna. Rest of them, Marconi, Yagi-Uda, and disc cone antenna are Marconi, Yagi-Uda, and disc cone antenna are resonant antenna. Okay. Roaming antenna is a non-resonant antenna. Antenna is polarized in the plane of the field perpendicular to the electric field. So option A is the correct option. It's not magnetic field. It cannot be polarized in perpendicular to both electric and magnetic field, and or parallel to both electric and magnetic fields. Okay, only A is true. Okay, thank you very much.